down, freezing cold. That's how we already know when it's here. My dog will probably do it for Louis Bell. That's just all he know, he don't know nothing else. I tried to show him. Yeah, I tried to show him. Yeah, 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 yeah. Gone on you with the pick and roll. Younger Flame, he in sicko mode.
This here with all the ice on in the booth. At the gate outside, when they pull up, they get me loose. Yeah, jump out, boys. That's Nike boys hopping our coast. This shit way too big when we pull up.
All right, Jared Fleming, good morning.
Good morning, bro. What's happening?
Nothing much, buddy. This is crazy. This is the new show. This is day one.
Dude, day one, way too bright and early for me, my man.
Damn, dude. Son, where'd you find this?
There we go. Hold on, one more for you, Fleming. We got the bomb drop here.
Oh my god, dude, that's too good.
See, this is my lunchtime, baby. So,
dude, I don't know how that's possible, man.
Yeah, I wake up every morning 4:30 and get the day going. So, well, hey, man, I'm super pumped to do the show with you. The new welcome to the show, man. As far as the new host goes, man, we're gonna have some fun.
Yeah, dude. Thanks a lot, man. I really look forward to the opportunity to just chat it up, man, on the regular with you and with everybody. So
yeah, a lot to talk about. A lot of weightlifting. Are you going to AO finals in like what, 4 weeks now?
Bro, you been living under a rock or something?
Yeah. Oh, you're lifting. You're lifting.
Yeah, dude.
The comeback kid. So listen, you went into CrossFit. You got hurt in weightlifting. You know, horrible injury. And then went into CrossFit after you got better. And now You're back in weightlifting, making a huge comeback. Kind of talk to the people. What happened with CrossFit, by the way? Like, why'd you stop CrossFit? Is it just not as cool as weightlifting? Is it not the same?
Oh, dude. I mean, there's a whole lot to talk about and all that. But, man, I mean, you know, the story's been out for a long time. The long short of it is just that, you know, after I blew out my knee and started coming back into training, you know, I needed to do something, you know, for my body and for my mind, but weightlifting just wasn't it. Just after, you know, I was honestly, I think I was kind of traumatized. I think this might sound like a bit of a over exaggeration to those who have like been in the military or whatever, but I feel like I had like PTSD in a way from it. You know, I mean, I was afraid to lift a barbell again, you know, afraid to get hurt. So CrossFit kind of filled a different space for me. And, you know, I think deep inside I knew that, doing CrossFit was the way to get back into weightlifting for me, though at the time I didn't really believe that, but so, looking at it hindsight, man, that's kind of, I think my subconscious
crazy.
Was
so you had like,
through.
You had goals though, when you were doing CrossFit to like legitimately go to the games.
I mean, anything I do in life, I strive to be the best at, you know, like the first time I picked up a barbell, I told my parents I was going to the Olympics and they're like, okay, you know? So everything I do, I shoot as high as I can. Like, dude, I just started playing guitar like 5 months ago and I'm like, all right, bro, I'm going to be like Stevie Ray Vaughan. But
oh my gosh,
I don't know about that, but we'll see. You know?
I love
but
that
every,
attitude
you know,
though, man. I mean, that's the attitude you have to have, man, to succeed. You gotta wake up and grind and, you know, shoot high, you know, why not? Have fun with it.
Dude, that's what found, kind of helped me find my way back to weightlifting was like, I started playing guitar. I have an instructor that comes over, or he's like my teacher. He's like my guru. He's like my musical guru, dude. He's awesome. He comes in, he's been coming in once a week, but this week we're starting twice a week. He comes in and we work together and we play like Johnny Cash or whatever. But basically what I'm getting at here is, as soon as I picked up a guitar, I was like striving for excellence. You know, I wanted to be as good as I could be. I wanted to like dominate the world with music, you know? And I'm like, holy shit, like that's intense. And then I started just going back into the gym and messing around, lifting some weights. And I was like snatching like 140 or 150. And I'm like, I called my dad that night and was like, Dad, you know, I'm just really good at weightlifting. And he started laughing in the phone. Because he's like, Jared, I've been trying to tell you for years now, you know? And that day I just decided that he said, Jared, listen, I haven't competed in 30 years, but if you compete at the Arnold, I'll compete with you.
Yeah.
So in that moment, I was like, dude, all right, like I have to get back on a platform. Like I've been given a gift that I need
so
to
you're doing,
exploit.
You're, for sure. And you're doing AO finals coming up, and I can't wait to see you lift because I'll be there. I'm taking Kyle out there, and got Michelle will be out there from Team Do. We got Russell Jordan lifting, and I'm super pumped to get out there. I mean, this is my first national meet, USAW national meet in like 2 years. Gosh, maybe even longer. You know, so this is going to be crazy for me. I'm pumped to get out there. But as far as you lifting, though, I mean, you talk about the PTSD type situation that you were in. I mean, is that still with you? Are you scared? Are you going to approach that bar and just, you know, be in your head? I mean, what are you feeling right now?
Oh, dude, no, man. I spent really the last 3 years of my life, like, trying to get my mind right, you know. I went to, like, a really dark place. So, really, dude, all I've been doing over the last 3 years is getting my state of mind into a place that's super comfortable and strong. So,
yeah.
You know, I wouldn't, let me rephrase that. I am at the best place I've been in my entire life. And, I mean, I'm ready for whatever challenge is thrown at me. You know, I see the bigger picture in a lot of ways now in life. And, there's nothing in weightlifting that can really scare me at this point. You know what I mean?
Wow. It's such a mental game, man. As you know, it's all mental. You know, I mean, I could make a case. It's 100% mental. There's nothing physical about weightlifting. And, you know, to balance a career as an athlete in weightlifting, Fleming, and then also to balance life as a young kid, as a young man working up the world of life, you won't talk about a tough situation, you know. And I think guys like me and you that are a little older and, you know, we've been in the game for a while, I think that's kind of the yin and yang, is to try to figure out the yin and yang with weightlifting in life. And it sounds like you're in a really good place mentally and physically, and you're enjoying weightlifting again and having fun. But at the same time, you're fierce and you're competitive and you're making this comeback in weightlifting. And I think that everyone is super excited to see the comeback.
Yeah, dude.
You know. So talk to me. I mean, was CrossFit just not as fun as weightlifting? I mean, come on, talk to me. Because everyone has this thing that CrossFit's so fun. Everybody always asks me, why don't you do CrossFit, John? Why don't you do CrossFit? It's because it's fucking boring. I mean, there's like I don't like it. I mean, like I appreciate it, whatever. But it's just like, why do I want to walk up things on my hands and run and do pull-ups and throw things against the wall? Like, to me, this is nothing exciting about that. Like, I like lifting big-ass weight, so therefore I'm a weightlifter.
Yeah. Dude, I don't know, man. I love CrossFit. I love CrossFit, but I love weightlifting even more, you know? And I think, to be honest, I think the reason I like weightlifting more, well, there's a couple reasons. A, I'm just way more naturally gifted at weightlifting than CrossFit. I mean, there was, after doing it for a year and a half, I was not ever going to be like Matt Frazier, and I was able to see that, you know? So, the biggest reasons I didn't stick with CrossFit is I just wasn't naturally as gifted. I mean, I walked into the, you know, well, I think back right before the open earlier this year in like February, I walked into the gym and did like 153 and like 175. And I'm like, dude, these are numbers almost good enough to make a world team this year. So what am I doing? Like messing around with CrossFit. And I took the last, you know, 6 months since then to just decide if that's what I wanted to do, you know.
Well, come on, you're one of the best weightlifters in America. You have been number one in America. You're a freak weightlifter, and I think you're right. You're drawn to what you're so good at. But on the other hand, though, I mean, I feel like if you really loved CrossFit, you would have stayed with it, possibly.
Nah. Anyways, I mean, I think CrossFit's great, dude.
Oh, you're being honestly, so politically correct right now.
No,
you're PC right now.
Yeah.
Fleming.
Here's the thing, you're trying to please all of our
listeners. Why don't you just tell the people that CrossFit ain't shit compared to weightlifting?
Yeah, bro. To be honest, I'll chalk it down to this, dude. I was talking to a friend of mine the other day, and he said there's a difference between mindlessness and mindfulness.
Okay.
And what I tend to find, and I think a lot of people may have experienced this, in states of like long aerobic or endurance type workouts, you go through like a phase of what's called like mindlessness. So not mindless. You're kind of mindless of what's happening. You're just kind of in this dark place. Like everybody's like, get in the dark spot and stay there, you know, or the pain cave. But in weightlifting, you're in a state of mindfulness, right? So you've got like 3 seconds or 2 seconds from the time the snatch comes off the ground and is over your head, right? So if you're not like on the razor's edge, you know, if you're not throwing bullseyes, like you're not gonna make that lift. So I love weightlifting more because the amount of focus and mindfulness it requires to be the best is something that CrossFit doesn't do for me. So that's really the difference for me, you know?
So I love how you say that. Right now I haven't, you know, like said this publicly or anything. I mean, I haven't done a podcast in, gosh, what's it been now? Like 3 weeks and things. So it's been a while, but, you know, with my back and kind of my body, I'm, you know, kind of, you know, refueling, as a lifter. So what I've been doing for the past, gosh, actually about 3 straight weeks now, it's actually almost 3 weeks and a few days, is I've been doing exactly what you're saying is with the whole more mindless situation where I'm into squash, man, hard. Like every day for like two and a half hours, I'm playing squash. I have a coach. There's a team at the gym. And I go in there after a long day's work and I just smash that ball as hard as I can over and over and over, working on my swing, working on my positions. I'm sweating. I'm moving. I'm hitting. You know, I'm working on being graceful, but at the same time, I'm working on being violent. I'm working on hitting the ball hard. And it is like weightlifting like that, where you got to be smooth, finesseful, but also you got to be very aggressive. But it's a little bit more of a mindless situation where I'm just like therapy. I'm just hitting the ball and I'm just not thinking and I'm just enjoying myself and, you know, getting fit and being happy and just moving my body. Where you're so right. Weightlifting is like you got to just focus so much on every little thing, even when you're resting, you know, even when you're about to approach the bar. It's crazy like that. But anybody out there that doesn't know what squash is, YouTube it. It's the most badass sport in the world. It's not racquetball. Racquetball sucks. Squash is a super explosive, fast, violent, in-your-face sport.
Dude, yeah. Squash sound, dude, I'll tell you what. Squash has got to be number two because spike ball is definitely number one. Have you ever played spike ball?
Oh, spike ball is ridiculously stupid.
Dude. You must suck at it then, dude. I don't know anybody that says that unless they're, well, bad at it. Dude, the best. I teach CrossFit classes 2 nights a week out here. And last night I had everybody doing spike ball for the warm up.
Yeah.
Dude, I get so addicted. It's just like, it's like weightlifting in that it's so fast.
But here's the thing. You're comparing squash to spike ball, Jared. You are a son of a gun.
Like, I guess I am the redneck of sport.
Spike ball is a little fun little game you play. This is a legit game, squash. That's like you could be a world champion in it.
Dude, you make it sound like it's polo or something. Like you're riding horses and like swinging your broom handle stick hammers and hitting the things. Is that the same sport?
What, Harry Potter?
Yeah, you playing Quidditch. You playing Quidditch.
Well, I tell you something too. I'm getting good, man. I'm 3 weeks in. I'm getting good, and I'm like you with guitar. Like I'm like all in it. Of course, that's how we are, Fleming. Like I'm all in it. Like practice. I went out to Dick's Sporting Goods yesterday and got like a case of balls. My coach gave me one of his old rackets, and I got my little bag. And like, dude, we'll see. I'll throw some YouTube videos up of me playing some matches.
Dude, I would love to see that.
I'll live stream it on Facebook.
Dude, next time we see each other, I'll bring a spike ball net. Yeah. And you can take me to the squash court. I mean, look, I've played the, or mat.
I'll do it with you, Fleming. I've played the spike ball a few times. I like it. It's fun, but come on. Baby game.
Yeah.
Baby game.
But dude, hey, I can't dog squash because I don't know that I've ever played it. When you said squash, all I thought of was cricket.
You're crazy.
With like the big mallets and the,
you're crazy.
The game my grandma plays on her lawn.
Oh my!
That's what
God.
I thought. That could be offensive. I'm not sure.
Yeah, it is offensive.
Like a big thing.
You're comparing it to spike ball. Just go ahead and YouTube it, you son of a gun. Go ahead and YouTube Nick Matthews. He's like the Ilya of squash.
He's the Ilya of squash.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, I'm about to be the Ilya of spike ball, dude. So if you ever want to get in a tournament together, just let me know.
Hold on, let's get a bomb.
Honestly, I think I train in spike ball more than I train in weightlifting now, dude. To be honest with you, but it's making my lifts better, dude. I'm getting more explosive.
Well, you're moving. You're kind of having that mindless fun. It's necessary. Like I always remember, like video games. I've wrote a few blogs about this in the past. Like video games are so important for a weightlifter. I mean, if you don't have a job and you were like us back in the day, where like all you did was just lift weights back at like, you know, the Cal Strength days.
Yeah.
But you know what we do is we just play a lot of video games. You know, because it would just turn off our mind and relax our body. Play some video games and then go back in the gym and lift, and play some video games and then go back and lift. So I think it's always good to kind of have that. You know, to become a champion. Hey, when you see me though at AO Fleming, I'm gonna be skinny though, man. You're gonna be shocked,
dude. You're gonna shit yourself too, man. The last few weeks I've only weighed like 85, 86 kilos. So, dude, you're still probably bigger than I am right now. What do you weigh?
I stepped on the scale yesterday. I weigh 190 pounds.
Dude, that's exactly what I've been weighing. Yeah, like 190, 191. That's like 85, 86 kilos, dude. My math.
So you're
right.
Telling me that your lifting is an 89?
Yeah, dude.
Really?
Dude, 96 is some big boys now, man. I remember back when the heaviest I ever was like 100 kilos. I was at the OTC eating fucking hotcakes and pasta like crazy, dude. And I was a big boy. I almost didn't make weight that year at Pan Am's, dude. Yeah. That was...
What year was
I
that?
Still bombed out, but... Oh, dude, we were there together that year. That was in Venezuela in 2014, yeah. I think. Or 15, maybe, you bombed or 13.
Out. You didn't bomb. Oh, wow.
Yeah, dude, okay. I did.
I went 3 for 6, though. I didn't have a good meet.
Dude, I was rooming with Cooper, and that was right around the time I was weighing 100 kilos, dude. I was, like, way too heavy.
Right.
And I went to weigh in that morning. Weigh-ins were at the, like, at the little hotel thing that we're in, if you could call it that. It was just, like... You remember, dude, it was just super exotic. It was like a little, fuck, I don't know, dude. But
I got so drunk that meet. Some guy was selling Bud Lights.
Dude, I remember, man. I remember.
Well,
dude.
Because
we
all the money that we
deep fried tostadas and fucking beer on the guys. Yeah. I wish you guys could like plug in to our brains and relive this moment because this was actually hilarious. John, you were like trying to climb like a telephone pole or some shit, dude. It was ridiculous.
Well, everything was so, oh my god, everything was so cheap. Like a dollar got you like a case of beer. You could have like 12 beers for like a dollar. Like it's like, so I was just spending money like P. Diddy, and I was like just eating and drinking and running around, and I'm like, oh my god, I've spent like $10. It's insane. Like I felt like a rich person.
Dude, I remember that. That's exactly the demeanor you had. It was hilarious.
Yeah.
I just remember, Glenn Penley was there with us too. And, right outside the arena was this girl with like a huge, like a pot full of hot grease on like a propane burner. And, she was just hand making and hand rolling these little, I don't even know what you call them, dude. Like not a tostada. Cause that's like a hot pocket, like a Mexican hot pocket, and there's a word for it, guys, and I'm sure some of you know, so I'm probably fucking it up, but dude, she cooks it right in front of us, and I remember she pulled yours out and it had this massive hair in it. You're just ate it.
I didn't care, man. So well, dude, good. We were out there in paradise, man. I mean, it was even though it's a country that's I've never seen poverty like that, but you know, we were at this like little resort thing. So, but what were you saying? I interrupted you.
When? I don't remember, dude.
I don't know. I'm just excited to see you lift, man. So 89 kilos, Jared Fleming, new co-host for the show here. And as you can see, these are pre-recorded. We're not going live anymore. So these are going to be uploaded on YouTube and iTunes. And then, by the way, eventually, I think probably in the next few shows, we're going to film the shows somehow. Anybody that's listening, let us know on some good ideas how we could film each other. And kind of do that, splice it together. So, Fleming, here we are on the comeback. AO Finals 5 weeks out. You know, everyone's excited to see you come back. You know, take our listeners back to the very start on, you know, what got you hooked on weightlifting in the first place? Because it seems like weightlifting is one of those sports where I know too well in this story, where it just keeps pulling you back. It's like Godfather, Al Pacino. Right when I thought I was out, they pull me back in. You know, dude, you just can't escape the love for it and talk about the beginning.
Yeah, dude, that's exactly how it is for me, man. I honest to God, I thought I was done lifting, but something just, so when I thought it was totally done and I had put all those dreams and just everything behind me, it literally did. It just kind of gave me a little whisper in my ear and it was like, hey, like, you can have this back. And I was like, really? So, but the story of how, you know, I thought, dude, the question that you asked is such a deep question, and we'll probably, you know, back and forth between you and me, like, this will probably be, you know, the rest of the conversation, to be honest, because, you know, over these last few years, I really I contemplated, like, my whole life and kind of where I was going, what I was doing, and I went to, like, a really deep place, and, you know, I finally, honestly, I didn't really see exactly why I started lifting until a week or two ago. It wasn't even that long ago. It was like a week ago. I actually figured out why I started to lift. And I think most people know I started when I was 10 years old. So, I started to lift before it was a popular thing, before you really did it, at an age where people thought it was bad to do that. The answer as to why I wanted to kind of was lost to me for a long time. But what I came to realize was, you know, it goes back to my childhood, and growing up, I was incredibly insecure and not confident in who I was. You know, I remember as a kid, like, looking in the mirror and asking myself, you know, or saying to myself, not asking myself, but saying to myself, like, one day you will be confident. One day you will be strong. You know, one day you won't be able to, or you'll be able to defend yourself against, you know, pain and misery. And I mean, that's super deep, dude. And, but I, you know, as we were getting into this podcast, I feel like, and it goes much deeper, you know, I mean, but these types of things are important to share, as far as, I think a lot of people wonder why I, you know, so as a coach now, you know, I look at my athletes and, you know, talk to them about why they're in there, what they're doing. And, you know, some of them know exactly why, and they're in here because they want to, you know, be better at this or that, or their mental confidence. And then there's some who are like, I don't even know why I'm in here. And I'm like, then why are you paying me? You know, like, you really need to stop and look at your why and why you're doing this. Cause if you're just mindlessly going to the gym every day, after you're going and working 8 hours a day, after you're doing some other side hustle every day, like, you're just going to burn out, you know? But for me, here's my why. So coming all the way back is, as a child, and this is super vulnerable, you know, and before I get into this, I do want to share that, you know, a lot of my childhood and things that happened between, like, my mom and I, you know, that really kind of shaped my future. I have since, you know, found peace in, and my mom and I both have. So as I share these things, it's important to remember that, where I was then is not where I am now. And so as a child, or, you know, my childhood, my mom was, you know, on the edge of being, you know, either mentally or physically or emotionally abusive. You know, we could put any three of those categories. And so as a kid, you know, I have memories when I was younger of, you know, my mom yelling or yelling at me or hitting me or whatever. And
jeez.
Yeah, you know, and I don't mean it to come off as I'm a victim, because that's not how I feel. Just to kind of paint a picture in people's heads of, you know, where I was at the time. But I have one memory that I've kind of boiled it down to as to why I started lifting. And this is, I actually figured this out last night as I just kind of sat with it, because
wow,
I wanted to be able to share with people, you know, a very powerful message, you know. But there's one memory I have burned in my brain. So I think, I'm pretty sure I was 6 or 7 years old. I might have 5, 6, or 7, something like that. And I remember my mom sent me up to take a nap, and as a rebel child, I never liked to do anything I was supposed to, and in everyone's defense that ever tried to rope me in. But so I remember I went up to take a nap, and I saw my dad walking out behind the house. And I grew up on a farm, so there was a dirt road behind our house. And I went to say hey to my dad, and I knocked the screen out of the window, and it fell on the ground. And I heard my mom scream from downstairs, and I immediately felt the fear of God inside me. And she came stomping, running up the stairs, and flung the door open to my room, and I'm standing there, and I got hit. You know, she hit me and knocked me to the ground, and I remember her pointing and yelling and screaming at me in a fit of rage, you know. And
just for knocking the screen off?
Yeah. So, right. And so I just remember crying and praying to God, you know, or what I thought I knew of God at that time, and just asked that, you know, someday would, you know, this pain would be taken away, and that someday I would be able to be strong enough or big enough or confident enough to defend myself. Because at the time, you know, I mean, I was like 6 or 7. So, I was unable to defend myself, and I prayed to God and made a promise that one day, you know, I wouldn't ever be able to be a victim like that. You know, I would be like the biggest, strongest, most confident person in the world, and that there was nobody who could diminish me. And so coming back around, you know, I mean, that's why I wanted to point out and say that the relationship that my mom and I have today is not what I had in my childhood. And her and I struggled tremendously, and that road and that journey is honestly what pushed me into weightlifting. It's kind of one of those things where my greatest pain ever became my greatest, you know, gift. I think had it have not been for an abusive relationship or with my mom, I don't think I would have ever found weightlifting. And I feel like weightlifting kind of saved my life, you know? So that's my why, dude. And that's super deep. And, I feel like it's important for people to know, like, you know, the reason I was so good at weightlifting wasn't because I was any more gifted than anybody. You know, there's a lot of people that are more gifted than me, but I wanted it more than anybody, you know. And to be honest, the only person that I've ever competed against that I felt like wanted it that much, you know, would be like you, Kendrick Ferris, you know, Colin Burns. I mean, there's a very small few people, and amongst all of those people, and this is only opinion, but I felt like nobody could want it more than me because of the pain I had felt was deeper than anybody's. And that's why I feel like I was such a fierce competitor, was because, you know, I refused to be anybody's loser or anybody's victim after what happened to me, you know, I felt like as a kid. So,
man, I'm so glad that you shared that this morning, Jared. Yeah. I mean, I didn't know any of that, and my heart's breaking as you're telling this story. And I know that you're only touching the surface with this. And, I mean, just having a 4-year-old son myself, I couldn't even, I mean, this hits home for me, 'cause I couldn't even imagine, you know, doing that to my son, or, you know, just imagining my son going through that. So I got a big stomach ache right now, man. And I feel for you. I just want to give you a big hug right now through the microphone, but, I'm glad that you guys have a good relationship now and that you're able to talk about it. And I love the fact that you were able to really dive deep within kind of your closet with your skeletons, and kind of figure this out, you know, and on what's the root of the weightlifting, and not only that, but just your past and accepting it and moving forward. And that must be a very freeing feeling to have a relationship with your mom now and accept the past and understand that there was benefits to where you are now due to your past. I mean, am I right on that? Is it a freeing feeling?
Yeah, dude. I mean, it really is. You know, I think once I was kind of able to, man, it freed my whole life up, dude, because the more things I was able to dig into and open here, excuse me just a second, dude, let me drink some water. Hang on.
Well, I was just going to say, while you're doing that, I mean, you know, the whole dark orchestra, the whole skeletons in the closet, I mean, this, you know, I could relate to this as far as, I have my past and my father and drugs and, you know, everyone kind of knows my thing, but.
Well, share it, dude. I don't know the story, man. Like, well, I'd love to hear
a different show, you know, but it's like, I can feel you to a certain extent, and like, you know, I kind of found weightlifting from a similar path to that, kind of rooted from bad things in my life. So I think there's a connection between bad things and a barbell. And I think there's a lot of people listening right now that can relate with their own story. But the best thing I ever did was just walk into my closet, sit down with my skeletons and hash this shit out. And it's freed me up for the rest of my life. And it sounds like you did the same thing. And I always tell people that's how this all started. My blog, Dark Orchestra, the book, everything is basically confronting your past you know, to move forward in your future. And I you're a perfect example of just a huge success, man. And I don't know, man. I'm glad you shared it. So I'm,
yeah.
It's gonna make watching you lift an AO even that much more exciting. Just knowing, you know, all of this now.
Yeah. Yeah, well, I appreciate it, man. It's really important stuff, dude. Our childhood especially shapes who we become, you know, until, like you said, and I never understood, you know, exactly the dark orchestra and the skeletons in your closet, you know, until you explain it now. And, you know, for me, what that says is, you know, just sitting with yourself and finding out who you are, you know. Just a second, dude. I'm sorry. Damn.
You okay, man?
Yeah, dude, it's just morning, so I think that I'm a little phlegmy, but
Fleming.
But right, exactly.
Sorry, I can't believe you combined squash, the greatest sport in the world, to spike ball. You're never gonna live this down. You're never gonna live this down.
Hello. You there?
Yeah, can you hear me?
Oh, dude, I got thrown back to halfway through the episode and it started talking.
Whoa.
Yeah, dude, it was weird. Sorry, man. Like, it went back and started talking about squash and spike ball.
No, I said you're never. No, that was me live. I'm saying you're never going to live it down comparing squash to spike ball.
You just said that?
Yeah, I just said that.
Oh, dude, it was weird. My phone made this like rewind sound when that.
You know
happened,
what it is? So. It's probably the aliens. You see, there's alien sightings. It was,
dude, oh my God.
Fox News and CNN last night.
Seriously?
Oh yeah, it's all over the mainstream media.
Dude, you've got to be fucking with me right now.
No, go to Tucker Carlson. Type in aliens, and he's even done a few like the last like 4 months. He's done multiple shows. Oh yeah, dude, there's sightings all over the place. Like, saying that aliens don't exist is stupid. I mean, we have proof everywhere now, and it's like, are they aliens? I mean, the Bible talks about, you know, the end of days having the devil's you know, demons and all that kind of stuff, you know in the air looking over at us before the end of days, kind of checking us out. It says in the Bible that we'll see things that we don't understand in the sky and all this kind of crazy stuff, man. And it's freaking creeping me out. That's I would say I'm just gonna buy some more guns and ammo, but
oh my God,
I think,
dude,
at this point,
make tinfoil hats, dude, so they can't read your brain. I think that's how it goes.
I don't know if guns and ammo are going to fight off the aliens, you know? Cause,
dude, you know a good alien movie is with Tom Cruise, War of the Worlds? Dude,
oh, that's
came
actually
out
a great
high school
movie. It's creepy.
Dude.
Movie. Yeah.
That's a good movie. It's like a, dude, I don't know. Yeah, and Independence Day.
Oh,
all-time
classic.
All-time classic. Dude, man, I got to watch the fucking news sometime, dude, because that sounds pretty ridiculous.
Oh, yeah, man. It's freaking crazy. Well, they just had a on Tucker Carlson about like 4 or 5 months ago, they had the all these airline, these military pilots, like high up military pilots. And they have footage of a UFO out in the middle of nowhere. And they it was like chasing them. They have full footage of it. And they were like, no, that was a straight up UFO. That wasn't anything we've ever seen. And the way it moved, all the military pilots and generals and stuff were like, no, that's not America. That's not world. That's from a different world, how it moved. And then how it took off in a blink of an eye. He's like, that's technology no one's even ever thought of. And it's crazy, man. Look it up.
Dude, I've been the one under a rock. I need to look at that up. Dude, look that up. That sounds crazy.
Yeah. Yeah, it's good stuff. It's a little creepy. So, well, hey, we got to wrap it up because I have a job now, Fleming, and I got to get ready for work.
Yeah, dude. Well, man, this was great. This is great. We'll have to lock down a good time for both of us to start doing these once a week, man. Like, find a good flow.
No, I'm having a blast with you, man. I love the chemistry. We just, you know, chat about weightlifting and life, and we have so much more to talk about. So there's a lot more to talk about. And, I mean, yeah, we could do 1-2 a week. You know, I kind of want to record them and put them up on YouTube. I'll put this one up on iTunes probably within the next few hours. I'll have my wife slap it up on the tunes here for people to listen. But I want to really take this to the next level. I want to do like videos and record and YouTube, and like I want to be able to like maybe even somehow interact with people in a live way through social media while we're doing the show for Q&A. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I have a lot of ideas. I'm just super pumped you're a part of the show now. It's, you know, Weightlifting Talk, you know, now we're recording it. I want to film it. I feel like it's kind of going a new direction. It's, you know, it's exciting. So thanks for joining me.
Dude, thanks for having me, man. This is going to be a good, this is going to be a fun, fun journey, man. I'm glad to be a part of it.
Yeah. Let's have some fun. And, what, 5 weeks, what, AO finals? When's your taper start? Like, what do you do? Like a 2 week taper?
Nah, typically 1 week taper. Dude, I've only been like really training for the last 2 or 3 days or week or whatever. So, we're just having fun this time, man. So no, nothing crazy.
Right. All right, man. All right, let's out of here. I'm going to do a little outro music, and I'll call you off air, Jared.
All right, man. Next time.
All right. Jared Fleming. Let's go.
Tell me lately why we barely talk. Hey, you know I'm trying to change, but it's very hard. Life's been getting to me, I just started smoking squares. But they ain't getting in my circle, though we still prepared. I'm still dealing with some demons that ain't really there. Grew up a screw up, pierced my ear and dyed my fucking hair. In seventh grade, I didn't have a bed, I had a share. The fuck you think I go so hard for? I got out of there. Have you ever had somebody try to take your life? Sometimes I ain't safe from myself when I stay up at night. Lately, I've been having crazy thoughts. The way I'm living, shit get crazy dark.